Hodder and Stoughton Audio presents Stay Home by Ava Pierce, read by Mandy Weston and Jasmine Blackborow. Before. It hadn't been supposed to happen as it did, but a push grew into a shove, and then, without quite meaning it to, the shove became, well, something else. And for an instant, just for a moment, the earth seemed to halt on its axis. With the bright sunlight dappling the floor and dust motes playing in the space between them, everything shrank to just those two people staring at each other with, what might it be? Confusion? Certainly. Horror? Maybe. Whatever it was, it seemed that neither could pull away from the gaze of the other, and somehow the moment of silence grew and swirled to feel almost as if God was in the room alongside them both. Then one crashed to the ground, gasping and groaning until, with one last thrash and tremble, it was all over. The other crouched to stare, unsure at that moment quite what had just happened. A surprised tear began to slide from the still open eye, hovering just above the floor. A finger caught it before it had a chance to fall, and a tongue slicked across the finger, faintly tasting salt. There was a slight creak to the knee and a step or two back, with a solemn look at the consequences of bad behaviour. It was the closest a person could ever be to another, and yet the most distant. It was the worst thing anyone could do in the world, and there would be no coming back from it. Footsteps to the door, and a final look over the shoulder. No, perhaps it wasn't the worst thing one could do. No, not at all. A smile, devoid of remorse, crept across the killer's face. Late. Caitlin.
Twat! Leave it! Else I'll tell Mum about you, just...
I really hope she's not actually going to tell me.
You're fat and you're ugly, her brother cuts her off. And you know it!
That won't irritate Ellie in the slightest, even though Harry sounds more touchy than usual. Whatever she is, she's definitely not ugly. And she's still at the age when nothing she eats hurts her model-trim dancer's figure, when it's all angular hip bones and short shorts are not yet the enemy. I expect she is now lifting one slender leg honed from hours and hours of street dance classes high into the air to prove it to her brother. I don't have the energy for this, and I don't think their hearts are in it either. The edge of heat that thrums their words when they're on the verge of really going for it isn't there. Ellie hasn't quite given up yet, though, although by her standards it's a weak counterattack.
You MIA bumwipe! Oi! Stop it, both of you idiots!
I interrupt as I open the door and stick my head into the den. I always try not to swear, as it seems so coarse and unimaginative, but sometimes I only just manage to catch it before it slips out anyway. Not swearing seems rather harder these days. I think we're all fraying a bit round the edges, aren't we? At 15, they're at that age when bad language feels creative and daring. But James and I have decided not to comment too much about this, as we work hard at not stifling them. So, although I can't help cringing sometimes at what they say, I look on it more as a recreational activity, temporarily enjoyed by my children, more intended to spice up their day than make real waves. To be honest, I'm a bit surprised that they aren't being more vocal right now.
Mom!
Says Ellie, in the voice she always uses to dob her brother in.
Hey!
I stop her there. Ellie looks quite shocked. I usually listen patiently to whatever she and Harry have to say, but I just can't handle them today.
I'm not interested in what's going on, and Dad's on a Zoom, and so he doesn't need a fuss-making. You need to tone it down, I add, trying to make my voice more reasonable.
My eyes flick to Harry's brand new day-glow strip trainers. His feet must be huge now, I realise. At this age, my children appear to change and grow almost daily. looking harder at Harry, who seems intent on the game on the telly screen and has his laptop open beside him. I think how he looks like a curious mix of the child he was and the man he will become, always dressed in oversized clothes that look the same to me, but which will have a logo or a zip that only he can see, and with as many forms of technology as possible close to hand. I have zero idea as to whether James is actually Zooming. He'd not been beside me in bed when I woke, and this meant I didn't get the usual morning run-through of his itinerary, although I'd be betting it's the same as yesterday, and the day before that. I'd drifted off again, and haven't yet got as far as going down to where he works. Instead, when I finally roused, I'd flopped down in front of my own laptop upstairs, still in my pyjamas, fiddling about with an idea for promoting my knits importing business that I named Caitlin Calling when I set it up a couple of years ago, before realising how egocentric that made me sound. James and the kids had joked at the time that I should get over myself, but the name stuck. I never can work out if I'm a serious businesswoman or not. Sometimes, most definitely, then others, not so much. Put it another way, it's probably a good thing that James is more diligent in funding the family than me. Still, before I knew it, I'd spent an hour tapping away in the box room upstairs, which has been my office since we moved into this house. The twins silently mime rude actions. Harry angling his vaguely in the direction of that rather odd room near the front door that we've never really known what to do with, where James has set up his temporary office. I'm not immediately sure of the best way of censuring them, and so I act as if it's perfectly acceptable. In theory, I try to be a good parent, and I know this means setting boundaries. But my urge to be the approachable, always chilled mum, the sort of mother that all their friends wish they had, very often feels overwhelming and gets the better of me. I yearn to be the type of mother rarely shocked or rattled or concerned about loud music or whether games and films are age-appropriate, and who makes sure there's always enviable mountains of food and drink. The parent I promised myself I'd be, back when James and I first met. This last intention has taken a bit of a dive in recent weeks, though, I admit, with everyone so bonkers in the shopping aisles. Anyway, what's the point of me making a fuss, really? It would be like shouting down a well to stop Harry and Ellie squabbling and pushing the limits. And once the twins are older and out in the real world, I expect they'll tone it all down. Everyone else learns to do this once they're out in the workplace, and so why shouldn't they? Rather than herd immunity, I think it's like herd behaviour, the way teens behave, and I feel they should be cut a bit of slack now that every day is the same and normal routines have been shot to smithereens. I mean, who'd want to be cooped up at home 24/7 at 15? As far as I can see, school has a major advantage of wearing them out a bit, and in giving them an education, of course. But like everyone else, Ellie and Harry are confined to barracks, where they spend a significant portion of their time bickering over nothing in a horrifyingly repetitive order. By the second week of listening to them, in what has come to feel like the background hum of the house's fabric, I can tell what time of day it is by the tone of what I hear coming from the den. It might be potty-mouthed and designed to shock at times, but very little of it is serious, I'm pretty sure. I love Harry and Ellie, to the point I'd happily take a bullet for either. But this doesn't mean that I'm not feeling a bit bored of motherhood and rulemaking at the moment. In fact, I think it would be fair to say that I'm enjoying this homeschooling malarkey a whole lot less than the twins, even though I know I should be taking an interest. And so should they. But it's not a GCSE year, and there's talk of postponed exams anyway. The Easter holidays are soon, and so I guess we'll review it all next term. When I'd said to James a couple of days ago that we should maybe be pushing them harder, he told me to give the kids a break, and that I should imagine what it was like being a 15-year-old in the midst of lockdown when, as he put it, they should be out larking about alongside their friends,
getting with all the wrong people and drinking alcohol purloined from the remnants of our final Waitrose delivery that squeaked in before normal life had to stop. So that is what I'm doing, giving them a break. I hate it when James deliberately uses teen speak, such as getting with. Worse, as he'd said it, he even made quotation marks in the air with his fingers. At that precise moment, I'd seen James as a classic trying-too-hard man, increasingly worried about any signs of a paunch, there aren't any, receding hairline, his is actually enviable, and where his life is going, chugging along very nicely, thank you. It was a fleeting moment, though. Maybe it's true that I can't remember the last time he surprised me over anything. That's hardly the crime of the century, and there are so many other things about him I adore. I don't kid myself that he doesn't find me irritating at times, too. Some days he can be quite short with me, and occasionally, when I make a joke, it seems as if his smile doesn't quite reach his eyes. But I'm sure he loves me, like I love him. He has got wonderful eyes. Nobody could deny him that. I still remember the first glimpse I had of him. It was at a party when we were at university. He was taking on a shots-drinking challenge, and entranced, I watched his throat swallow as he looked back at me through his lashes, the bob of his Adam's apple making my stomach flip and dive as I decided, yes. Love at first sight is real. He's so good-looking. Who is he? I must meet him. So I did, and as they say, the rest is history. But although James can be firm at times, I don't think he's ever done anything to make me change my mind much from my first impression of him. And I wouldn't want a total pushover to be my partner as, well, who'd want that? We're still having regular sex, which is more than a lot of my long-term married friends are these days. I try not to feel too smug. I guess I have the grumps these days, largely due to having to spend too much time at home. Home is supposed to be a place of comfort and love, and it is, but it's also a place where I quite often can't help feeling invisible to my family, other than when somebody wants something. I try most days to look around our lovely home and garden, and at my handsome husband and coltish twins, and I tell myself firmly that I have everything a right-minded person would want. I do. I know I do. It's just that, somehow, I can't quite shake off the feeling that when I was the age of Ellie and Harry, I'd expected more out of my life once my 30s were trotting over the hill, although I'm at a loss to say what that more really was. With each demand from one of my loved ones for a drink or something to eat, a little more of the gloss of my life feels scuffed. There are precious few times when anyone says to me, "Caitlin, sit down and let me do it." With each day that passes, I feel there's a little less of Caitlin left for any of us, me or them. I wish I could find a way to help them all understand this, but I don't seem able to. With Harry and Ellie now, I settle instead for an overtly dramatic sigh, with my eyebrows pointedly raised, as if to tell them I've heard and seen it all before. "Butthole," I think Ellie mouths at Harry, who responds by looking at his sister through narrowed dark eyes as he flips an even ruder gesture back to her. Loudly, I sigh again and cast my eyes around the rest of the room. I'm not sure when I had last properly entered it, but now that I notice the depressing state of it, I realise it must have been a while ago. The den looks wrecked. It had once been our dining room, but since the arrival a couple of years back of our lavish kitchen extension, with its huge skylight and the ridiculously expensive table, 12 it seats with ease, and the benches and perspex chairs I've placed around in a pretty much failed attempt at encouraging family time, it has been all changed for this space. Our redundant dining room has given way now to what I lovingly imagined would be a teen hangout, a place where they'd loll around with their friends, and I'd be invited in to share confidences over Ben and Jerry's cookie dough ice cream, laughing together and sneaking in the odd bottle of illicit lager without their dad knowing.
The picture before me of what the den has spiralled into is not how I thought it was going to be. And how I hate the phrase, the den now, as I suspect does everyone else in our house. When I'd christened the room, I truly believed the den brought to life a cool but deliciously arch US TV show of the 1980s vibe, whereby James and I could smile knowingly at each other in a private joke kind of way whenever either of the children uttered the den. That has never happened. But filthy or not, this room is where Harry and Ellie pass the bulk of their daylight hours. I banned them from spending all day in their bedrooms after my friend Shona drunkenly insisted, with far too much graphic detail, quite what it is that teenagers will do for hours, given the opportunity of endless me time. Even through the Zoom gallery thumbnail, as Shona chugged from her glass of expensive wine, I could see that she had that annoying know-it-all look on her face that I remembered from university. I hadn't liked it then, and it certainly hasn't improved with the passing of the years. But her words must have stayed with me nonetheless, as I've at least been strict about them getting up before the school day would start and spending their time downstairs. Behind the twins, the plush cushions from the Habitat cobalt velvet sofas look as if they have always lived on the floor. Used cups and plates and pizza boxes litter the room, and there's just stuff everywhere. And a pervasive smell, too. A malodorous mix of fetid, unwashed teen boy and Ellie's too strong eau de parfum. Actually, that's my perfume, I realise. She's obviously found where I had hidden it. The only pristine areas I can see are the two desks I installed for Harry and Ellie's homeschooling sessions. With their matching chairs tidily tucked under, and a faint bloom of dust on their surface, these two desks remain as virginal as the day I had them set up against the wall. My son looks to be busy playing Call of Duty Black Ops 2 on the large telly. I think he varies this with Fortnite and Grand Theft Auto. I'd be hard-pressed to name his favourite version of GTA, and goodness knows what else. I get the feeling that he's quite secretive about some of the stuff he's into that he thinks I might not like. I remember not wanting my parents to know everything I was up to at his age, and so I'm cool with that. I exaggerate slightly. There has been a tiny bit of me that gets suspicious at times over the detail Harry can click into occasionally when he is provoked into talking with me about games or what else he is doing on his battered laptop. When I get him to pull his head away from his various screens or his phone, that is. I can remember acting similarly when I was younger, in order to distract my parents from all the other, more illicit stuff I was trying to hide. But I don't honestly believe that my Harry has the guile to really get up to anything properly no good. The little boy he was still peeps back at me now and again, and he was such a sweet little thing. Even now, the very sight of him can make me melt with the physical sensation of love, just as I did back then. Ellie, meanwhile, has her laptop propped open on her belly as she flops on the floor, a huge and half-eaten bowl of popcorn beside her, and I can see that she's paused an old episode of Say Yes to the Dress. I suppose watching something fluffy and hopeful on weddings is verging on an act of deliberate provocation right now on Ellie's part, especially as she knows my views on both reality telly and shows that keep our fires of feminist debate raging. It seems that sexual stereotyping is clearly alive and well in London's E8, I sigh to myself, with Harry and his make-believe violence and tetchy online stuff, and Ellie getting ready to fall in love with the idea of being married in a long white gown. Hello? The 1970s are on the trim phone, and they want their attitudes back. It's obvious that schoolwork is definitely not on the agenda. I know I should push them harder to keep up to the timetable the school has emailed us, but I don't really see how I can do this with any likely chance of success. Especially while trying to run my own business and keep on top of all the things I have to do. Homeschooling is fine, I guess, if your kids are of primary school age, or swotty. But mine only ever do the bare minimum, even when school is running, and it's already caused too many arguments since this all began. I dare say Harry and Ellie can make up any lost ground later, even if we do have to bring in some private tutors. I've too many other things to think about.
Look, just keep it down, guys, I say.
And then I could kick myself as the once hit but no longer thus guys slipped out unintentionally, and I know it will have them rolling their eyes with amusement at my expense. I shut the door swiftly, so I don't have to see. We have some fairly new rules in the house. These came about after I had a meltdown on the second day we couldn't go out, when the kids were being iffy about loading the dishwasher. Ellie suggested at this point that it would be a good idea if, as a family, we put together a plan of the new way of doing things, and I agreed this was a good idea. The result was that we had a family meeting sitting around the kitchen table. At the opposite end of the table to where I've set out my 18,000-piece Ravensburger Evening Walk in Paris jigsaw. Yup, 18,000 pieces. £146.08, with nearly £20 delivery on Amazon, about which James had joked that the pandemic was more likely to kill me than I was to finish the puzzle. The upshot of this four-way powwow was that we agreed the following. No arguing. And in the wake of not being able to have our cleaner the usual three mornings a week, everyone should clear up after themselves and pull their weight in terms of general housework, and everyone should do their own clothes washing. Oh, and we would all respect each other and our opinions. I am probably the best out of the four of us in sticking to these rules, but that's only because I can't bear the clean lines of our minimalist kitchen and equally Spartan day room area not looking tidy, or the dishwasher waiting to be unloaded, or crumbs on the kitchen work surfaces, and so I keep those areas going, much to the relief of everyone else. However, I am sneakily proud that I have forced myself not to pick up the dirty crockery abandoned in other rooms, or sort out anyone's discarded clothes. It means that each day I have to kick James's rumpled tees and sweats from the day before under our bed, so that I can't see them, but he seems fine with that. And now that I have given myself a stern talking to, I am too. But in fair disclosure, the house slowly sliding towards bedlam with sticky floors and dust bunnies running rife does rankle with me, as it means the others are, as my granny would have said, swinging the lead. I'd rather cut my tongue out than comment, though. Purely because to give in to this impulse means that I'd lose all moral high ground by having fallen at the no-arguing hurdle. Moral high ground is important, I always think. Naturally, neither Harry or Ellie have put the washing machine on once. It sits white and serene in our utility room, a foreign territory to the twins. Their clothes live on the floor, like their father's. Well, Harry's probably don't, as I think he wears the same outfit every single day, and in fact he probably sleeps in it too, interspersed with Ellie simply ordering new stuff online to keep up her normal three changes of outfit a day. I suspect she's using my PayPal account, thinking I won't notice. Actually, I'd better check on that. There is one thing, though, that makes all of this tedious nonsense worthwhile as we muddle through lockdown. I have a secret. A thrilling secret. No, a thrilling secret. As if on cue, my telephone vibrates silently in the hip pocket of my pyjamas. My belly gives a little fizz, and I see a flush of goosebumps rise on my arm as I turn around and walk to the pantry to read my WhatsApp in private. As I stand looking at the stacks of tins, I know what I need to get me through the next few days, and it's not to be found anywhere in this house. I have a fleeting sensation of his breath on my neck. Disappointingly, the text is from James, who wants me to know that he could do with a coffee. Physically, he is no more than 40 feet away from me, but at this moment, it feels an ocean, which saddens me. It's a momentary sensation, though, overridden by one much more selfish. I try to push the thought away, but I can't. After I reach for the cafetiere, the kettle heating on the Arga, I go into the utility room, where there's still a faint whiff of the perfume that Ellie sprayed so lavishly on herself. Opening the hidden door to one of the cupboards, I dig out and pull on my running kit, chucking my pyjamas into the washing machine. I have tried so hard not to give in to this impulse that I've surprised myself. I declared it was over, and very much meant every word I said, at the moment I said it. There were tears, mine mainly, followed by a serious talk, during which we agreed that during the coming lockdown, it was only right and sensible that I should concentrate on my family. But I'm buckling. I'm not sure why right now, but all I can say is that it feels as if I have a pulse deep and insistent within me, demanding that I still it. Perhaps if James had got up to make his own coffee, I'd have felt stronger today. But he didn't, and I don't. I am ashamed of myself, of course, but not ashamed enough. "Be there in 15, I type. We always message and never phone. My message isn't to James. I pause in readiness for the reply, but there's no answering vibrate back. It's usually immediate, and I feel a flash of unease. Surely I've not been forgotten. Then I smile at myself. I know what he and I have together, and it's something rare and earthy, and he's not going to be forgetting about it, that's for certain. While I tap a foot impatiently as the kettle takes its time, I check the highlights in my hair under the spotlights. Not too bad yet, which is a relief, and it looks as if that new shampoo I'm trying is making it admirably shiny. I stuff it into a scrunchie before applying a slick of my favourite nude lip gloss and a squirt or two of the scent he gave me. It seems prudent of me to keep everything to do with my secret separate from the rest of my life. Consequently, the utility room and the privacy it affords me has proved a godsend for this, what with all of us now at home. As finally the kettle makes that noise it does before it starts to whistle, I tip my head to one side, pleased to see in the mirror that even with my 40th birthday not far away now, my neck and shoulders, and the rest of me actually, are still enviably tight and slim. I'm trim, but definitely not scraggy. I'd hate to be somebody without curves in the right places. I've thought before that if I were a man, I'd think I look good, even perhaps as much as a decade younger. I don't see anything in the mirror today to disabuse me of these notions. I don't much like the fact that my appearance is a bit too important to me, but I'd be lying if I pretended otherwise. And then I wrench the toggle a bit tighter than it needs to be on my running shoes, as if I mean business, which I suppose I do. Before I return to the kitchen to make James's coffee, I give myself a final once-over. I breathe in as I look sideways at my reflection in the mirror, standing on my toes and then plucking at the waistband of my running tights, ignoring the glint of my wedding ring. I could never remove my wedding ring. I made a promise all those years ago to James that it would be a symbol of our marriage, a marriage I am very much committed to still. But that doesn't stop me taking a last peek at the curve of my buttocks nestling snug in their Lululemon extra firm lycra. They look inviting. Then, as I'm not feeling proud of what I'm about to do, I open a packet of biscuits and arrange a few on a plate for my husband. And I nip into the garden and snip off a few early blooms, which I stick in one of the jam jars I bought online for just this sort of off-the-cuff moment. As I position this pretty tray with James's elevensies on his desk, and he lifts his blue eyes away from his Zoom to smile at me in thanks, I grin back. It's a genuine grin on my part, as this sort of look from my husband can always brighten my day. And of course, the thought of what I'm about to do not too far away would make anybody with a pulse grin stupidly too. "Just leaving," I type a minute later.
Ali. Even by my slatternly standards, I am a mess. The face staring back at me from the splash-pocked bathroom mirror does me no favours. A boy at the school bus stop once told me, rather cheesily, I had dancing eyes. That was more than 20 years ago, and I assumed he'd been trying to make me look a fool, that he'd have laughed if I'd seemed to believe him. The next day, his mate swore he fancied me, but by then I was too shy to do anything about it. A lot of water has passed under the bridge since then. Nobody would claim there's a shadow of anything dance-like about my eyes now. The whites are bloodshot, a maze of tiny lines crazily multiplying deep in my skin around them. It's a look that makes me seem much older than my 38 years. Worse is the flesh on my neck, which I see is beginning to resemble the ruches of an Austrian blind. Whoever has Austrian blinds these days, I ponder. And then I recall there is a blue one at the window to the rear of old Mrs. Graves' house down the street. She's one of my subjects in waiting, and so I must remember her when I'm next at Memmott's. Earlier, I awoke with a start from a bad dream of somebody trying to batter my door down. And now, the pee I've just taken smells cloyingly sweet, and that, with its vibrant burnt caramel hue, tells me I'm dehydrated. It was the same colour when I peed a couple of hours back, and I realised that, although I'd meant to have a glass of water before going back to bed, my attention had been diverted by my subject across the street. I could see him gesticulating, talking on his hands-free earpiece, at one point pulling his murky green T-shirt from his dark grey shorts before tucking it in again. And I must have been so absorbed in my snooping that I forgot to drink my water. The drinking glass rattles between the tap and the porcelain of the bathroom hand basin as I empty and then refill it. I sip, tentatively, but then I'm overwhelmed with thirst and I can't help but gulp huge mouthfuls. A mistake. As in a whoosh, all the chugs of water come right back up again. My stomach not yet ready for such an assault. There's a minute or two of me staring down at the hand basin as I hold on to either side of it. Grimly, I gather my feeble reserves of strength and stare accusingly at the glass now lying on its side near the plug hole as I will my stomach to settle. It takes a while, but then I am able to gingerly pad across the grubby beige carpet, navigating around my piles of books and bits and bobs to my seat at the cluttered round table in the bay of my front room window, overlooking the street. As I sit down, an unbidden sigh escapes my mouth. It sounds like, oof. Only old people or very worn out people make that noise when they sit. And I'm not old. The effort of all this movement makes my head thump, and I have to close my eyes. It's a while before I can look out of the window. It's how I spend most of my time now. Our building has four flats, including the basement, but we are all either too poor or too tight to spring for a window cleaner. Not that he'd be able to come to us at the moment. In this sea of gentrification that's changed my area almost beyond recognition since I moved in fact, I'm verging on proud of the fact that we are by far the grubbiest and most run-down house in the street. It feels almost a badge of honour, so blatantly a refusal to follow what passes for Hackney living these days, in my street at least. An attitude I like to tell myself is sparky and bristling with character. I've always embraced a sense of outsider. It was familiar to me when growing up. My parents making sure of that, what with our constant moves and new schools for me. And it's probably a factor in why I don't push harder for the rest of the residents in our building to club together and give the outside a spruce up. But dingy curb appeal of our house or no, I am glad for what I have. I grew up ricocheting through an endless array of crummy rentals as my parents struggled to make ends meet and weren't averse to the occasional midnight flit if things got really tough. By the time I came to sit my GCSEs, I think I'd attended 9 different schools in various parts of London. I was used to never asking my school friends to mine, which always felt terribly shabby compared to what I saw when I visited their houses, and I knew I couldn't rely on my parents not to embarrass me. The constant attention of being the new girl was murder for someone naturally introverted as I was, and I can't really remember a time I didn't feel awkward and shy, feelings that have never really left me. Safe within my tiny flat now, I get a little respite. Hackney is lively these days, though, and so it surprises me that it's become the place I feel most at home. But my time here has given me a stability I've never experienced before. This flat has been good to me, a little peeling paint on the window frame notwithstanding, and sometimes I dread to think what would have become of me if I hadn't found it when it was even more dilapidated and run down than it is now, and, to my joy, actually affordable to buy. I'm tobogganing towards glum thoughts, and so I force myself to sidestep this well-trodden path away from how I could have ended up and concentrate on nicer things instead. It's cold out, but the sun is bright. It's my favourite time of year, as the large tree rooted into a small patch of bare earth between the paving slabs outside our front garden is coming into leaf with its caterpillar green new growth. It's this verdant sprouting, when combined with the patina of grime on both the outside and the inside of my window, that convinces me few people going about their business in the street below will be able to see me. I like this feeling. Another month and the leaves will be so big, my view will be curtailed, which won't be so nice. I tell myself that at that point, I'm going to do some cleaning and make that window sparkle. I've let things slip far too much these last few months. I wonder if I should have spoken to my doctor. I've been a little hazy for a period. Not quite myself. But I never did, and perhaps my laziness has turned out to be a good thing, as, without me really trying to, oddly, this morning, I feel clearer headed than I have in weeks. Certainly up for a bit of rigorous sit and stare, as I keep an eye on everyone from my first floor eyrie. Since I was let go from work a while back, my scrutiny of the other lives in my street has come to feel probably more like an occupation than a hobby than is wise, especially when it comes to Daniel. He has been promoted recently from vaguely interesting to a definite project. Watching having become my primary occupation does bring me down a little if I think about it too much, as once I had been, even if I say so myself, rather a good teacher. But then I allowed things to fall to pieces. I'm sad about that, but possibly not as sad as I should be. Although I'm nosy by nature, getting way too involved in the lives of my poor neighbours feels, at the moment, necessary. But also, just a little peculiar. Still, I am nosy, and not ashamed to be so. I perk up when I hear the clink of the original Victorian metal gate to the garden of the house opposite opening and closing, and the slight creak of its hinges. I dip my head to get a better view through the branches, and snatching up my binoculars, I catch a jarring close-up glimpse of some hideous accident in a paint factory coloured calf-length leggings stretched over a pert derriere, while expensively streaked hair in a ponytail sways jauntily from side to side as its live owner trots down the path away from me. She looks the shiny personification of the phrase spring in her step, and she very much appears as if she feels that she deserves to be there, as if she is about to be rewarded. This can only mean one thing, IMHO, in my humble opinion. I had had to look up IMHO when I noticed it on Twitter for the first time a few years back, and since then I've been planning to slip it into a conversation, at the right time, of course. Until now, the opportunity has never arisen. I digress. That one thing causing such a bouncy stride has to be sex. The impressive level of bounce suggestive of someone who knows more than a bit about it. I have only had sex with 3 men in my life, and the liaisons with 2 of those were little more than a slippery fumble during Freshers' Week at university, and the noun men may be an oversell for those. It's not much for my lifetime to date, I know, but I tell myself that I should feel positive. At least I'm not a virgin. I have fonder memories of a female colleague's lips on mine. We were escorting a school geography trip down to the Granite Tours on Dartmoor, and late one night, when the kids were in bed, my heart beat faster than I ever knew it could, as we kissed more passionately than I dared to imagine. That was as far as it got, though, for when I went to sneak a hand near her chest, she got cold feet, and we never talked about it again. I like to think of myself as someone who may be pansexual. It seems so bold, and just about ready for anything. The problem is, I've found, that anything isn't ready for me. Opposite, I see the shiny woman briefly jogging on the spot, her ponytail a frenzy of swinginess outside the main front door to the expensive terraced double-fronted house. Number 66 contains 2 separate apartments, the top 2 stories being a rental with a revolving door of well-heeled tenants, and the bottom 2 belonging to Daniel Horn. The woman shoots a final look around before she adroitly sidesteps to her left, hurrying down the steps to Daniel's basement maisonette. Presumably, she's satisfied that she's not been seen. She's a local, then. She's not fooling anyone. Least of all me. Daniel looks to be in his late 20s, and he alternates a rather old-fashioned city suave of Brooks Brothers clothes with an off-duty look that has enough of the hipster about it to merge seamlessly with the young people around here, who probably wish they could afford to live in Shoreditch. I've walked down these steps several times myself, although after I watched his disaster with the cauliflower cheese and me then leaving him a small collie and a packet of cheese sauce to encourage him to try and make it again, both of which I later found in his dustbin, I haven't been back there recently. Despite this, I haven't stepped away totally from Daniel. He caught my eye when he moved in. I think it was the casual way he bossed the removal men about as he stood watching them lugging his possessions around that first hooked my attention. Most people his age rely on mates and a borrowed van on moving day, but not him. I didn't find his standoff attitude endearing in the slightest, and those removal men weren't impressed either, to judge by the looks they were shooting each other when Daniel's back was turned. I don't think he tipped them, either. Conveniently, I can see into a lot of his home from my window bay. The developer had spent ages on this property a few years back, opening it up, in estate agent speak. It belonged at that time to a young couple, until the husband was caught playing away. To judge by the endless skips outside prior to Daniel moving in, I think he then ripped out pretty much everything the developer and the young couple had done, including any original features, and started again with some quite extensive renovations. Aside from what I think must be a bedroom on the upper level at the back that probably overlooks his garden, and a bit beyond his kitchen I'm curious about on the lower level, I feel as if I can see pretty much everything. Certainly I've had lots of opportunity to keep tabs on Daniel over the last couple of months, in his lair, as he rarely employs his blinds or shutters, which makes me think display of all kinds is important to him. We couldn't be more different, I often muse as I look between the clean, empty lines of his home and the stuffed to the gills bookshelves and unruly cupboards of mine. Maybe this is why I find him so fascinating. It makes me smile to think that there was a time when I nearly gave up on him altogether. There was none of the drama of that previous couple, which I definitely missed, and in comparison, I thought him simply too boring. But my opinion has changed. Now I think, yep, Daniel is certainly criminally dull, but there is something intriguing about the sheer level of dullness he has achieved that I find compelling. And of course it helps that I can sit in my window and study him to my heart's content. It sounds lazy, and it is, but convenience has a lot in its favour. It must have involved a heap of hard work on his part to manufacture such a deftly persona, a task that, to all intents and purposes, Daniel has pursued with diligence, almost as if competing in an extreme sport of being a man with virtually nothing about him to recommend other than a superficial handsomeness. And as I saw him faffing about in front of his biggest mirror trying to fluff up a small patch of thinning hair the other day, I suspect even his looks might be short-lived. I am a natural-born cynic, though, and so I keep giving him the chance to prove me wrong. So far, he hasn't even come close. I had several abortive attempts at doorstopping our regular postie when I sought his name, who, surprisingly for such a dozy-looking man, gave me short shrift. But payday came when the John Lewis man couldn't deliver some crockery. Well, that's what it sounded like to me when I took the box in and gave it an exploratory shake. And I was able to learn my young neighbour across the way goes by the name of Daniel Horn. A high point of my early surveillance was a girlfriend he had. She looked a decade older and quite often extremely peeved with him. They had a slanging match in the street more than once, the loudest of which only ended when an Uber arrived and he bundled her into it before stalking back inside. I've not seen her for quite a while, and so, presumably, his plea during the spat of, "For Christ's sake, get a grip, Nicky, and just bugger off," had the effect he was looking for. What I do find odd in these days of online transparency is that there's surprisingly little I can discover about Daniel. He doesn't seem to do Facebook. Well, few young people do these days, I guess. Or Instagram, or Twitter, or any of the other platforms that I can access. After a fair bit of digging, I have been able to locate his date of birth, though. 1st of June, 1995. I'd been just on the verge of concluding in frustration that he must have created the Daniel Horn identity when I found this piece of the puzzle, and it wasn't long afterwards that I could trace him to a fairly mediocre city job with a fairly mediocre stockbroker. I was even able to track some of his trades, although they didn't look impressive to me. Perhaps I'm being mean. After all, he's managed to scrabble together the cash to buy nearly 2,000 square feet of prime E8 real estate on the expensive side of the street, which is a lot more than I have. The property on my side of the street is much more moderately priced, and most of the houses and flats are significantly smaller, although the money even they go for nowadays still seems eye-watering to me. Certainly, I wouldn't be able to purchase here if I were hoping to buy anything now. Another thing I find fascinating about Daniel is that he's not living the Hackney dream that pulls many folks in their 20s to our area of London. I believe the word is vibrant, according to the estate agents. He's not a big goer out, and I've never seen any sign he's gay, and he doesn't seem to have any mates who call around, or a regular girlfriend since Nicky, or a string of visiting casual lovelies. Vibrant certainly wouldn't be his middle name. And I can't help but ask myself why this is the case. The more I know about him, the less I know.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.